There's nothing like a James Bay track to hit you right in the heart.
Come on, let it go. Just let it be.
Let It Go catapulted James to superstardom and quickly became a celebrity karaoke fave.
Everything that's broke, leave it to the breeze. Why don't you be you? And I'll be me.
Since then, James has earned a reputation as a musician's musician.
Hold back the river, let me look in your eyes. Hold back the river so high.
Performing with the likes of Alicia Keys and Justin Bieber, and touring with Ed Sheeran and the Rolling Stones. James's new album is Leap, and it's his most personal record yet. While it might be full of uplifting tracks, it's still sprinkled with the James Bay magic that will surely have us reaching for the tissues.
Give me the reason, give one more check. Don't say goodbye.
Please welcome James Bay. Now, we're rather excited on the panel to have you here. And I'm not sure if you could hear it during that package, but most of us, pretty much this whole panel, was singing your songs to you, so forgive us if we were out of tune. But it's been a minute since we've had a new album from you.
Yeah, it's been a minute. It's been about 2 years and a pandemic, longer than I planned for it to be. But hey, what can you do? Sometimes these pandemics, they come along. Anyway... I finished this music in it was March 2020 that I got home. I've been recording in Nashville in Tennessee, and I finished an album. I came home, and the pandemic started, and me and my guys said, it's all right, a couple of weeks, we'll let the whole thing blow over. and that didn't work. So by the end of that year, I started writing again because it was the only thing I could do. We were in lockdown, and it was the same throughout 2021. But I got a bunch of songs in that period of writing that felt too good to sort of wait until album four. And I was just desperate to sort of get music out and keep it feeling kind of fresh, but not completely lose what I'd started. So even though it's taken a lot longer than I'd planned, like it probably has for so many artists, I actually love this album twice as much, having had to wait twice as long.
James, Mitch here. If you don't mind, let's talk about 2019. You're touring with Ed Sheeran, playing the stadiums of over 100,000 people. Some would assume that you were living the dream, but in fact you were struggling. Can you talk to us a little bit about that?
Yeah. I was, look, on the surface and on the face of it, I was absolutely living the dream. And genuinely, like, you know, I started that year, I was in America for 5 or 6 weeks. I did a headline tour there with a whole bunch of sold out shows. And then I came back to London. I did my first show there for a couple of years. And then I went off for months and months with Ed. And it was football stadiums. It was brilliant. But underneath, I don't know how to sort of fully describe it, because I suppose my life, you know, works in this way where I have these incredible sort of highs given sort of what I get to do for a living, which I feel so fortunate to be able to do, so lucky. I go out and tour on my own, I go with Ed Sheeran, I go open up for the Rolling Stones or whatever it may be. And the highs are unbelievable. And I guess it's only natural that they're followed by these difficult sort of lows, and it becomes this crazy roller coaster. And those lows were really starting to sort of get the better of me, and I wasn't quite sure how to handle it. And it's one thing, one kind of therapy for me is of course to write songs. Another one has become actual therapy, which seems really helpful. But you know, yeah, it's difficult learning how to deal with that. And I found a way after writing actually a lot of sad songs, which comes to me pretty naturally. And that whole process was actually, as you can imagine, sort of getting me down. But there was one or two sort of diamonds in all of that felt like songs with a bit of hope in them. And I found a way to write into that emotion, that hope, that sort of silver lining kind of energy. And I worked out, I could celebrate in these songs the people in my life that really hold me up. It's a select few people.
James.
And I could write to that and, you know, find something positive to say.
I'm just, can you please, because your songs get a lot of us sad middle-aged women through a lot of things, and you've now said the next. I mean, I've been known to grip my steering wheel crying in the rain like I'm in my own film clip, and you've said the next one is going to be even more vulnerable. Can you just steady on, sir?
We'll go slowly, yeah? We'll go gently, we'll go slowly. We'll hold hands and do it together.
Okay, thank you.
James, I've got to say, I'm a sucker for love. And you and your partner, Lucy, were childhood sweethearts, right? How do you write such heartbreaking songs when you act, like, where do you actually manage to find the real deal? How did you find the real deal when you were just a kid? How did you find such deep, unique love?
I guess it's just the type of sort of vulnerable person or sort of type of person that I am. There was a Nick Cave quote that somebody referenced to me the other day. He apparently said, when we're sad, typically we write towards happiness, and when we're happy and when everything's okay, we typically, as songwriters, write towards sadness. And it does sort of ring true, I think. I don't know what it's about. Sometimes for me, you know, there's people close to me in my life who are going through a difficult time, and it resonates with me, and I try and sort of express it,
James,
the best way that I can. It sort of goes like that, I guess. That's how and why it happens.
I'm amazed that we found the meaning of love on the show tonight. Your new album, Leave, is out this Friday, the 8th of July. James Ray, thank you so much.
Thank you.
And that's it. Thank you.